Hi, I'm Jen Storer, acclaimed children's author, creative writing mentor to thousands, and chief inspirationalist here at girlandduck.com. And I've got something super special for you today because I've been talking to Leonie Dawson. Those of you who know me will know that I've been following Leonie for years. I've been using her Shining Year workbooks in my life and in my business for many, many years. I was a member of her academy and I've done practically all of her e-courses. I love Leonie. If you don't know, if you've been under a rock and you don't know Leonie, I happen to have a lovely little bio here on my phone. Leonie Dawson is the international best-selling author of My Shining Year Workbooks, a self-made multi-millionaire, and mentor to highly sensitive hippie oddballs around the globe. In today's conversation, we range far and wide, which you would expect from this brash, funny, highly creative, and highly charismatic woman. I suggest that you get a pen and paper because you're going to want to pick her brains. You are going to love this interview. Oh, and one more thing. Yes, there is a language warning on this video. So if you have little ones, I suggest you put them in the cupboard under the stairs. I'll see you in there. Now you can see me. Yes.
Oh, hello, beautiful human. I can't believe we haven't already talked. I feel like we're already friends.
I'm the same. I feel like, well, it's kind of like that creepy thing, you know, when you you think someone's your friend, but they're not.
They don't. But, I mean, in your case, we actually are friends, so we'll allow it.
It feels like that. Yeah.
So I love that we've matched. I've matched my shirt to your background today, so that's nice.
The moss green. Yeah.
Lovely. I just did it because it's like the cleanest shirt of my husband's I could find and steal. So, you know.
I love it.
You're so much better presented than I am.
I was saying to David before, am I having a bad hair day? And he's going, just bloody turn the camera on, you know. I was thinking, that's, you know, you're talking to Leonie. She's, you know,
that's,
she's
right,
the greatest mentor in just putting yourself out there and not being such a perfectionist and fuss.
That's right. It is Leonie. I've had like one of my consultants, it always looks really beautifully put together, didn't even have, like, usually has gorgeous lipstick and all that kind of stuff, and one day she turned up and I'm like, oh my god, I'm loving the vibes you're putting down, and she's like, oh, the baby wouldn't go to sleep and I just didn't even have time to put a face up. But then I thought, fuck it, it's Leonie doesn't give a fuck at all.
Great role model.
Just right. Turn up like I do on an everyday basis, ta-da.
And get shit done.
Yeah, exactly. And smash the fucking patriarchy at the same time.
I'm glad we got that in straight away.
I'm all pamped. I'm all ramped up today.
All right. Well, I have a list of questions here that I just want to, you know, but I just want to freewheel as well. But there are other things that I want to ask you because it's just, I mean, there's so many things that I want to ask you. So
love it.
Yeah. So do you want to jump right in now?
Big time, babes. Big time.
All right. Okay. So one of the things that
I'm going to move around though as we do it because
that's right. Is your back sore?
I don't, like, well, a little bit, but it's actually quite warm here today, and I don't want to say that and like, oh, look at me in Queensland, and it's just a little bit warm, but I need to put the fan on.
Right. Okay. You do that. I've got the heater on. I've got a knee rug.
I know. Like, I feel bad saying it in front of Melbourne friends. I'm like, sorry, Victorians, but just a little bit overheated. Yes. All right. Carry on, my friend.
Okay. So I did say to you that, you know, when we were talking about what topics we might discuss, I was sort of mentioned about the intersection between creativity and spirituality and business. I kind of see you, your life is kind of like this Venn diagram. I feel like, you know, you kind of got that intersection going really, really well. So I just wanted to, you know, ask you sort of, you know, do you see your creativity as an expression of your spirituality, or do you not even think about it in those terms, or is it just evolved that way? Like, what do you reckon?
I think Well, so I think creativity is kind of, it's like a tool for a way for me to connect with my spirituality. You know, creativity is such a huge healing force in my world and in, you know, all the worlds. And so for me, you know, one of the biggest things that I do for myself every single week is on weekend afternoons, I am on solo mama retreat. So my kids can run wild. They can, you know, build elaborate Minecraft worlds, whatever they want to do. But I am going to take some time to be with me and connect with me and fill up my well, because if I don't, I am a cranky gorilla of a mother. Yeah. And the way that that ends up coming out is that I'm either reading books or I'm like in my art journal and creating and doing e-courses. And I always take notes in my art journal while I'm doing e-courses. And that for me is like a room of one's own, as Virginia Woolf would say. You know, like that art journal is a room of one's own. It's that place for me to connect in with my soul and my spirit and have that one place in the world that is just for me and only that.
So what I really like about that too is that you say you do that regularly. That's not just a treat that you occasionally do. It's a commitment.
Yeah, and it's also, if I don't do it, like you can really tell. Like that week, you can really tell, like in the level of like the quality of my parenting, the levels of my grumpiness. So for me, it's really not negotiable now. And I don't overschedule our lives. We rarely do things on weekends because I so firmly believe that we need the time to connect to our own souls. We need to live homely lives. And, we need to build in like those personal Sabbaths for ourselves. And even though I'm not a part of a religion that practices the Sabbath, I need to create that Sabbath for myself and for my family.
And then that has a beautiful flow on effect into your business as well.
Completely. Yeah. Because if I don't have like those regular Sabbath experiences, I get really burnt out and I get bored and I don't come up with the best ideas in my business. And when I do create, it's not from this space of an overflowing well. It's a well that's like steadily depleting and is starting to bucket up some dirty water.
I just love it. I just love it. And I wish that we could revolutionize everyone out there to start to think more like that and stop sort of striving so much and being always in that sort of yang energy. And try to find that balance. And that's what I really admire about you, is that seeing that you're I know that you're not perfect and I know that it's not always happening that way, but you have a clear vision, you know, and you do it. And I love that.
That's yeah.
Beautiful. Yeah.
And as well as being somebody who I guess it's not really, it doesn't necessarily feel as much like a choice as more of a necessity. You know? Yeah. Like my body is going to conk out if I don't behave. My mental health will conk out if I don't behave. Like it's just fucking standard, you know. Yeah. I've done this a million times over where I haven't followed that flow and had good boundaries for myself. And it's pretty messy when I don't.
Yeah. So we get burnout and we get boredom, and they're the sort of the burnout and the boredom, this sort of the boredom I would imagine which that leads to apathy or what does that lead to for you?
I mean, boredom I'm fine with, but like if it's like kind of the good kind of boredom, you know what I mean? Like we're like, oh, what will I create next? But the boredom of like, this all sucks and I hate life.
Yeah.
That's not a good boredom. That's burnout boredom.
That's burnout, yeah.
And yeah, let's not do that. I've got a sign in my office from a Brené Brown quote that says, I honor my need for rest and play.
Yeah, beautiful. I love that. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, that has a flow on. That works. That's healthy. Yeah.
Yeah.
But the other thing too with you is how, like, you seem so young to have had all, had all these realizations, you know. So, like, who influenced you early on? Like, when did the lights go on? I'm really fascinated too, also, more questions. You know, you had a rural upbringing, which means a lot of isolation and not as much, you know, physical sort of contact with culture and the world beyond the farm. So I just really interested in that period in your life. And was there a turning point? Was there one, you know, pivotal moment? Or was it just, you know, luck? Did you get around good people? Did you fluke it? What sort of led you on this path?
So I think first and foremost is I am likely Asperger's. I haven't been formally diagnosed yet, but I'm obviously neurotypical of some sort. And what it means is that my brain tries to make really rational and logical decisions. And so from the very beginning, I've always been able to kind of look at a certain situation and go, well, is that right or is it not? You know, so when people said, you're a weirdo, you're a freak, whatever, I didn't believe them. You know, when somebody tried to tell me that I was unlovable, I didn't believe them because it didn't make sense to me. And when you looked in the natural world, animals come in all different shapes and sizes and personalities, and none of them are unhappy about being here. They're all just happy to be themselves. And so we can replicate the same for us. You know, like a zebra isn't, I like to talk about zebras, like a zebra isn't going, oh my God, like if this stripe on me was just different, if it was a different shape, if I had skinnier stripes or if I looked different, that is when I would be worthy. That is when I would be loved. No, like a zebra's like, look, yeah, I'm a zebra. I'm a motherfucking zebra. I'm eating grass in the sunlight. This is magnificent. I am down with this. Hooray. So, you know, that to me is like the simple truth of it all. So just because we're human doesn't mean that we should stray away from the divine truth that we are supposed to be anything but what we are. And also I remember when I was a teenager and I cottoned onto the fact that everyone was pretending to be something they weren't in order to be cool.
So you saw through that as a young person, you saw through that.
And you could also see, you know, and I was like, I found it really difficult to make friends. And so I was watching constantly. And I was like, oh, they're trying to be cool. And even when they manage to be cool, they're still not happy because, you know, they've had to pretend to be something they're not in order to be loved. So it's not a true kind of love. Whereas if I just be myself, I could have a really fun time with it. Like I could have the most amazing time under the sun because being myself is quite fun. It's quite adorable. Some people will love it and some people will absolutely not. And that's okay because I'll be with my own best friend and that best friend is me. That's the person I'm going to spend the rest of my life with every single second. So I might as well have a really scrumptious time with them.
Yeah, love it. It's just gorgeous. And so did you read anything that influenced you in those earlier days or were you just sort of cogitating on stuff? Or I know that you had that amazing art teacher.
I did. I feel really lucky for anyone who's, you know, encouraged me creatively. But honestly, even if they hadn't, I don't care. I had some English teachers tell me that my writing was too personal and too flowery, right? Do you think I've listened to that advice? No. I was like, in my head, I was like, you're wrong. This is what makes me magnificent. This is what makes my writing incredible is when I make up words and when I'm overly verbose and when I'm deeply personal, that's when it gets good.
Yeah.
So it's just that little voice in your head that goes, you know what, that's actually not true. Like, so I'm not going to base myself and my perception of myself on other people's opinions because it's always a flawed perception. What I'll do is trust in my own self and continue on delighting myself and it will work brilliantly. My mum was great at childhood development stuff and like was very encouraging of creativity. She told us not to get creative jobs. We weren't allowed to be creative jobs. And we weren't allowed to have businesses. They were like, you know, my parents were like, you cannot be an artist. You're a starving artist. You cannot have a business because all small businesses fail within 5 years. And you cannot earn over $75,000 a year because then you'll pay too much tax.
I love it.
So as somebody who has made a career out of creativity and running businesses and earning way more than $75,000 a year, I've carried on not listening to anyone and having a great time with it.
So always listening to that inner voice. Yeah. The strong inner voice, as opposed to the inner critic, which we talk a lot about when I teach creative writing, is the inner critic, and it's a constant battle for a lot of people. So what do you think about the inner critic?
I think
how's your relationship with the inner critic?
I don't have one because they're a construct. Like that's the patriarchy at play. Like I don't believe that zebras are like looking at the shit that they've just done and gone, God, if only I'd done a better shit, or if I'd only eaten the grass in a better way. No, they're just carrying on having a great time. And even children, when they make art, they don't judge it. So why the fuck should we? Therefore, it's a construct. It's a man-made construct. And I'm not interested. It's not going to that's not going to make me have more fun. It's not going to make me create more. It's not going to make me more productive. So no, I shan't listen to an inner critic voice because that makes no sense. I'm just going to listen to what delights me and that will be enough.
Mm. And that's sort of behind why you're so prolific too, I would imagine, because you're not coming up against those blocks all the time. You just keep moving and keep producing. And this whole thing of done is better than perfect. You know, that keeps me moving to think, progress, not perfection. That keeps me moving as well. Yeah.
Yeah, really. Yeah. And guess who's not thinking am I good enough to write a book? Like straight white men, they're not thinking it, guys. So therefore we know it is a construct of the patriarchy. It's a construct of white supremacy. You know what we say to that.
Yeah.
Smash it all up.
Oh, this is so much fun. It's so much fun. Can I talk to you a bit about leadership?
Because
what I think is really interesting is that when you run an online business and you start to have a bigger following and a bigger audience, at some point along the line, you kind of become a leader, whether you wanted to become a leader or not. And so how has that come about for you, and how have you dealt with it? How do you feel about being looked upon as a leader? Do you take that role on, or have you resisted it in the past? Or is it just something, again, that you just roll with? How seriously do you take it?
Not seriously. I don't really take much seriously. So I think where my obligation is my obligation, I feel, and this is something that I've felt anyway, is that I want to make sure my business is a win-win-win for all involved. So not just a win-win, but a win-win-win. And so what that means is it's going to be a win for my business.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to be for me personally, it's going to be a win for my client. And there's got to be somebody else who benefits from that, whether, you know, like that's through our philanthropic work by donating to certain charities, or in some way we try and better the world in this balance. So for example, my goals workbooks, I sell them every year and they're an international bestseller. They've been used by 400,000 people worldwide now. Love it. People love it so much. And we also donate it and give it away free of charge to charities around the world. So I like that win-win-win philosophy. Yeah. And that to me is kind of an important part of being a leader. And then also trying to guide people into business practices and life practices that are better for the planet and better for the people on the planet. So it's because I have a platform, it means that I have to talk up about issues. I have to talk about the climate crisis. I have to talk about politics. I have to talk about anti-racist work and social justice work and intersectional feminism, because if I have a platform, then I've got a duty to try and raise the consciousness of stuff. And so for me, like also learning about racially problematic words and stuff like that is cultural appropriation is a huge issue, especially in the hippie realm. I am somebody in the hippie realms. Most of my clients are creatives and hippies. And so it means that I do have to, if my clients say anything and they've may not realize they've used a problematic word, I do have to step up and say, hey, I'm just letting you know, I know that you've not used that intentionally, but this is actually the history of the world. And so we don't use that word. And people are so grieved by that. So that's kind of, for me, that's how I look at leadership. But I also kind of consider it like everybody is their own leader. I don't want to be a guru of anyone. Ew. Don't follow me. Just go like, wow, look at that chick doing stuff. I can totally do this path for myself as well. And I will cheer you on.
Walking the talk and talking the walk and whatever it is. Yeah, I see that in you. I see that in the way that you lead. And I've heard you actually say, you know, I'm not your mother. I'm not your therapist. I'm not your financial advisor. You know, I'm none of those things. So I love your kick-ass approach to coaching people along. It's like, well, just get your head stuck out. What is it? Get your head out of your ass.
Pull your head out of your own butthole. My art teacher would tell that to me. And so, like, I have to give props to Mr. Turia because he'd say to me, Leonie, you're like the most incredible, beautiful bird in the sky and you're flying your wings. You're like, wow. Look at me. I'm really flying. Am I flying? Oh my God, I'm flying. I'm magnificent. This is incredible. And then you overthink it and your head swats around and like inserts itself up into your own asshole and you plummet to the ground in great somersaults. And it's such one of those visuals that stayed stuck in my head for years now. And so I try and tell my clients like, okay, this is like what my art teacher told me when I was 16, great creative advice. Do not get your head stuck up your own butthole. Do not plummet to the ground.
Yeah. Just get it done. Just keep moving. Yeah. Keep flying. Yeah. Yes. I love it. The hippie thing, that's also of interest to me. So again, when did you decide that you were a hippie? You know, when did you decide that kind of world really, or did you decide, or did you, again, was it just a natural kind of growth that you sort of felt really comfortable in that environment?
I mean, I think I've always been alternatively leaning anyway. And, you know, I call myself a hippie because it's probably just the easiest, like, they're like, righto, she's one of those. Like, I'm completely left-leaning in my politics. And I like to dress in rainbow tie-dyes. And, like, it's fairly obvious, like, hippie. So in terms of, like, I don't identify with a spirituality anymore. I used to identify heavily as New Age or pagan. For me, it's just not even a word. Like, there's not even a word that describes it anymore. It just is what it is. And I can always kind of tell when people are also going to be part of my audience because they all dress like hippies as well.
Yeah.
It's just like that creative expression on the outside as well on the inside.
Yeah. Love it. Okay, cool. What else have I got here? Goal setting, that's one of your biggest things, goal setting. And the way that you teach goals, the way that you keep people on track with their goals, your goal workbooks, which I've got, of course. Da, da, da. And I've been using your goal workbooks for, I think 2016 was when I first started, but it might have been 2015. So then, and they're just like, there's something that I look forward to every year to get both of them. I get the life and the work one. And it's a ritual, you know, it's a ritual to fill them in and it's a ritual to keep going back to them. And in fact, I was looking here, I've actually got 2019 on my desk as well, because I tend to go in and out of 2 years together. You know, I'm often going back to see, well, what did I do this time last year, or where was I at in my business, you know, in my stats and stuff like that. And it'll always be in the book. Whereas it may not be in the computer.
Completely.
Like, you know, I'm such a paper-based girl, and the colour and the fun of these sort of keeps me on track. So with your goal-setting stuff, again, was there a pivotal moment there, or was it just something that you instinctively knew was a good thing, or did you come across some kind of personal development book that really, and you went, aha? Was there an aha moment?
For me, it was, I remember like years and years ago, I was thinking about setting, like creating a business. Well, I wanted to be able to leave my career, like I wanted to leave my public service job to have a creative business. And I was thinking, how on earth am I going to do this? And I remember thinking, right, I need to go for a walk. And then I did something really unusual. I had a Tony Robbins Hour of Power CD from the library. Now I want to like asterisk the fuck out of this because Tony Robbins is one, problematic as fuck. And two, I'm not a Tony Robbins fangirl. It was just this 1 hour of a CD 15 years ago that, and like, you know, he does have some really useful, like topics, and he does talk about goals and stuff like that. Anyway, he had this like hour of power, and like being an Australian, you know, when they get like really overly excitable American, I'm just like, oh my God, calm down already. Just calm down. But he's like, all right, in this hour of power, you are going to change the rest of your life. And I'm like, we'll see about that, mate. And he's like, I want you to set 3 goals that you absolutely will achieve in the next 12 months. And I thought, ah, fuck it. Right. Why not? I'll give it a red hot go. And I set those 3 goals, and one of the goals was I want to make $30,000 in the next year from my business. I came home and I turned the CD off and never listened to it again, returned it to the library, never bought anything else. But I thought, right, okay, this $30,000, if I commit to this, how am I going to make this happen? And I remember looking at how I was selling my art and my prints online at that point. And I thought to myself, I don't even know how on earth I'd get to $30,000. And that was when I had to like realize like, oh, in order to get to that, I have to grow and learn new skills. I have to learn about business and marketing in order to get there. And it was just a real pivotal point for me, like, oh, okay, if I want that to happen, I have to start changing how I do things to get to that. And so I started then setting goals for myself like that. And by the time I got to 2009, I was pregnant with my first baby, and I knew that in the year ahead, I was going to become a mum, and that was going to be a really difficult transition. I knew innately. Some people take to it like a duck to water. No, I knew it was going to be a fucking train wreck, and it was. And I thought to myself, right, I need to set myself some goals in order to be able to go through this year. And it's kind of like building, like strapping myself to the mast of my ship, lashing myself so that when the waves get really big, at least I still remember who I am and what I wanted to create. And so I looked around to see if there was any like goal books out there that could help me, and there was nothing, and anything that was really black and white and masculine and you know, really just like power and money kind of stuff, and that didn't make sense at all to me. I wanted to create goals in a really holistic way that looked at, like, all of my life, my relationships and my family and my health and my creativity and my self-care and my boundaries, along with my business and work, career and money, all of that stuff. So there was nothing out there on the market at the time. And I thought, you know what? I'm going to make something for myself, and I'm going to make it rainbows and unicorns because that's what I love. And so that's what I did. I took like 3 days to create something. And I thought, oh, this is really cute. I'll pop it online, see if anyone else likes it.
So just let me stop you there for 2 seconds.
Yeah.
3 days. So you just,
yes.
So this is how Leonie works, isn't it? This is like a wild donkey. Yeah.
Yeah, big time.
Right. So you just got in there and you just went hell for the leather for 3 days until you had something that you were happy with. Right.
Yeah.
Beautiful.
Yeah. Why not? Like, it's like I just wrote an erotic novella, my first fiction book in, you know, fiction writing in like 20 years or so. And I don't know, it was kind of like maybe a week of writing. It was so fun. And it was like only like a couple hours a day. It was so fun. I was like, why not? Like, Fucking why not just get in, get it done, and get out of there before your head gets stuck up your own asshole.
So you had the journal, you had the goals workbook, or sort of with the unicorns and stuff.
Put it online, so it'd be cute if like 10 people bought the PDF, and it ended up being used by 1,000 people. And then the next year, 1,000 people were like, that changed my life, I need it again. And then they told all their friends about it, and then it just kept on growing. So it's now it's like 400,000 people who use it, who like you are like, this is a really important ritual to me. And it's the same thing for me, because like, it's such an important thing for me. Like I have all like the last 10 years now of growth in life and business. And I have all of the planning and the writing there for it. And it absolutely has changed my life. Absolutely has changed my business. And it happens to do the same for the people who use it. So why the fuck not?
Yeah. It's extraordinary. For those who are watching who've got online businesses, because they're always sort of interested in the nuts and bolts behind things that you do. So when you first had that PDF that you were selling, was that from your blog? And did you have PayPal in those days? Or how was it? What was the actual logistics of how you did it? I mean, nerd alert.
In the olden days, yes, it was all.
Did they send you a check?
Yeah, I know. Some have, which is really cute. PayPal's been around for a billion years.
Okay.
I think I've been using PayPal since 2004. It was one of the first.
Right, okay.
Yeah. I don't think I was using I would have been using eJunkie at the time, which was kind of like a shopping cart system where if somebody bought something from you, then they'd get the digital download. And I had a blog, and I had a mailing list, but I didn't know that that was important. I thought it was more important to have blog subscribers. You used to think in the olden days. Wrong. It's like, your mailing list is always the most important thing. Like now people think, oh, social media numbers, that's the most important thing. Wrong! Mailing list is still the most important. Mm.
Social media numbers are such a furphy and such a distraction for a lot of people. Yeah.
Totally. Yeah, and so it can be taken away from you.
Absolutely.
It is.
Yeah.
Like TikTok's just about to get deleted over in the US. We're probably going to lose access to it in Australia. Who's like, for all the people who've just gotten TikTok famous, like...
Yeah. Yeah. So long. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And I have friends who built up Facebook audiences. Like I've got 130,000 people on Facebook. I've got friends with 400,000. They're like, who gives a fuck about your Facebook numbers? Because nobody's really on there. And even if they do, they're not going to see your shit anymore. So it's not a sustainable way to build a business.
No. And you can drive yourself insane trying to figure out algorithms. And I mean, I think I heard you refer to SEO as the dark arts, you know,
completely.
Yeah.
Completely.
It's just,
it's bonkers.
It's a head wreck. Yeah. It's a head wreck. So then you started to self-publish the books, and they became this extraordinary thing. And then you went only last year, wasn't it? You went with a publisher, a traditional publisher.
I've done 2 years.
2 years
as the publishers. But I'm pulling out to go back to self-publishing, because self-publishing is the bomb.com, guys.
Yeah. Yeah. I wondered if you would do that. I wondered if you would do that. There's just no profit margin once you give up the self-publishing. Yeah. But of course,
the profit margin is so sad.
Yeah. The thing that must have been really tough for you, though, self-publishing to such a massive... logistically to such a massive audience, that must have been a bit of a head wreck at times. Print runs and print bills. Yeah.
Well, yes. So I have done kind of three models of publishing now. So I've had the publishers, which was fine, but nowhere near the amount of profit or control that I need personally. Mm-hmm. I need more data. I need to know on a daily basis where my sales figures are at, so because it keeps me motivated. Like, I want to know. Like, it's not going to work for me to have monthly figures. I don't give a fuck about monthly figures. I need day to day. I need to know results. So I've done that. Then I've also done printing through China, you know, like the big print runs. It cost me about 500 grand a year to print them, because we're printing like large volumes. And then they would get shipped across And we'd have distribution houses in three countries because my readers are really diverse. So most of them are in the US, but then 60% in the US, 20% in Australia, 20% in the UK. But in that, there's a whole lot of variance. Like, I've sold to over 150 countries now. So it's kind of insane. So that absolutely was a head wreck, especially having to hire staff to manage that process and the customer service of like managing the distribution of like 80,000 packages being sent out in a 3-month period. Like, kill me now.
And it's so, I mean, it's a workbook, so it's really time sensitive. You know, people want their fucking workbooks on before January the 1st. You know, they want to get, So everyone's like, where's my workbook? My life doesn't start until I've got my workbook. Yeah.
Yeah. So that's now, like, I do print on demand, and it comes with its own limitations in that I can't do spiral binding, I can't do extra cool shit with pages and stuff like that in terms of, like, you know, putting in sticker pages and crazy shit like that. But on the upside, it doesn't make me crazy. It earns me a lot more money, and I don't have to hire a large team. Yay! Yeah. So I'm going to continue with print on demand forever now, I think. There's no point for me to go in any other direction.
It's exciting. It's also exciting to see how you've learned along the way. And even that is a kind of a leadership role that you're doing unconsciously in some way. You know, other people are watching you. And watching you evolve and watching what you're going through and then sort of relating it back to their own lives. I saw the struggle that you had managing a team, and I so get that. And I know that going forward, my business, I need to keep it lean because managing teams is not something that I ever want to do.
Yeah.
I'd be a lot like you. I just couldn't.
And for some people, it's great. Some people love managing a team.
It's a personality thing, that's all.
It really is. And sometimes you can only find out by going there yourself. Mm-hmm. And so I remember sitting at my accountant's like back in 2016 and just crying. And he was like, this is why I've got the box of tissues, Leonie. Like, this is like, everyone cries in my office. And
various reasons.
Various reasons. And I said, I just can't believe it. Like, why hasn't it worked out for me? And he said, it's really simple, Leonie. Like, your business was always going to get to this point. You're a high growth business. You're always going to be on that trajectory. And at a certain point, you have to decide, do I insource and hire a large team in order to grow, like keep up that growth? Or do I outsource and work with other teams, like other people's businesses? And both are going to have their pros and cons. And largely, the right decision is based on your personality.
Yeah.
So, and you can only find out that by doing it. So I felt a lot less alone in that. And like, I hadn't made a mistake. I just made an important learning about myself and how I work.
Yeah. And I think too, I see a lot of myself in you too, in terms of, I know you like to work quickly and I know that you like to work spontaneously, you know?
Yes.
And I'm like that too, you know, I get an idea and I want to act on it. You know, I don't want to have to fucking brief a whole lot of people and, you know, I just want to get in and do it. I just want to get in and do it. So I understand that frustration that you must have felt when a team was literally slowing you down.
Yeah, really.
It's basically just a personality thing. It's not a bad thing. It's just,
totally. And that way as well, that when you do, I have a part-time assistant now, and I absolutely get that I am going to drive some people absolutely mental as a boss. Like, absolutely mental. Completely get that. So what I do need to do is find people who are really happy to be flexible and for things to change and for them to have things just surprised on them. So me and my assistant have a running joke. It's not really a joke though, because it absolutely happens. She doesn't know what I'm launching until she gets a sales email about it, you know? And then she's like, oh, okay, righto. I see what Leonie's done there. It's 9 o'clock at night. I might just slip onto my computer and just check if there's anything she needs me to do. Because I just disappear into my little planet. We also make a joke as well. She said, you know, it would be a really bad idea for any fangirls of you to work for you, because they would be under the misassumption they would have access to you, when I know that you're going to disappear for weeks on end and that you are barely going to talk to me, and that that's actually when I know you're at your most happy.
Yeah. Wow. She's the best. Oh, that's the best kind of assistant.
Yeah.
Especially for an introverted creative.
Yeah. Yeah. So you just got to, and the only way you can find them is just by like dating a lot of frogs, you know, and upsetting a lot of people on the way and go, well, that wasn't the right fit for anyone, was it?
Yeah. Yeah. But it sounds like you've got a great understanding too. And sometimes when we're looking for an assistant, it's good to think of, you want kind of an intrapreneur, you know, someone who's really interested in entrepreneurship, but they don't want to actually do it themselves. What they want to do is get really involved in somebody else's business. And someone else was telling me the other day is you need to look for someone who's not got a massive ego. They're not going to be like your assistant. Obviously, she can take being left for long periods of time, being left alone, doesn't need you to pump her up. So
yeah,
that's kind of a bit, that's egoless. You know, it's a really, it's a really unique sort of quality to have in an assistant.
Yeah, and I think really the only way you find them is just by trying out a lot of people and seeing who upsets you and who you upset.
Yeah.
And the ones that is an upset-free environment, ta-da! Like, and enjoy it for as long as it lasts, because it may not be forever. Like, my assistant may, you know, go on and do other things, and I'm so happy and excited for her to do that. But if we can have a great time while we do this together, that'll be amazing.
Yeah.
I've had other great assistants in the past where it's worked really beautifully for a number of years, and then they want to explore something different within themselves, and that's great too. Like, we don't have to marry each other for the rest of our lives. But if we can find a relationship that's, you know, in right energy for right now, then that's great.
Yeah. Oh, how are we going for time? We've got about 20 minutes left.
Oh, look at us. Yeah,
I know. I wanted to say I downloaded on your free shit page, which is massive. There's so much free shit on your website. So I suggest everybody who's watching this get over there and download some shit. Productivity habits. I love your productivity habits. So I downloaded that one, and I just wanted to run through a couple of those and just ask you to sort of expand a little bit on them, because they're really cool.
Please.
Really cool. So, we've kind of looked at, one of them is I don't wait for the muse to hit. So I think we've really addressed that. We've addressed writer's block. We've addressed inner critic, and we've addressed, you know, getting your head out of your butthole and getting on with it. So I don't think we need to, clearly you don't wait for the muse to hit, you know.
No, it's just got to be done.
Yeah, it's just got to be done. Right.
Yeah.
So you also say that you keep a list of ideas and creative goals. So can you share some of your current creative goals with us at the moment, or is that sort of stuff that you like to keep to yourself, or?
Oh, no, I'm not. I don't have any secrets, really. So I always like to have a few different like creative side projects going on. So at the moment, me and a bunch of friends, like some are artists and some are like haven't done art since primary school. We started an art journal club. So we all like make art like in a couple of pages of a journal, and we send it on to the next person. There's like 15 of us around Australia and New Zealand. And
this is literally snail mail.
It is absolutely snail mail. They are physical journals. So we've been going, it's been nearly a year since we started. And so people are just starting to get their original art journals back that's now full of like these beautiful pages of all different styles and artworks. And it just feels so beautiful and intimate, and it's brought me so much joy. I highly recommend having crazy side projects like that. Like, nobody's ever going to see that. It's not going to make me any money, but it has brought me a crazy amount of joy and inspiration. Other creative goals is I like to have like a bit of a stretch goal in terms of what I want to create. So at the moment, I really want to create like a lot of lead magnets, like more free shit to give to people. So I've got like a number that I want to get to.
Leonie, can I stop you there for two seconds?
Yes.
Can you explain to some of our viewers who won't know what a lead magnet is?
Oh, of course. Sure. It's basically where I just give free shit to people in exchange for their email address. So like I'll create free posters, or I'll create a free ebook, or I'll create a free video training series, or a free webinar, or anything that's free that's going to help someone. That's a lead magnet, because it means that if you give me your email address and I can send you more free shit, I can give you this piece of free shit right away.
Beautiful. And the other thing about a lead magnet too is that it starts to build that know, like, and trust factor, which is crucial for a business.
Yeah, really. It sort of builds a connection and a friendship. It means that you can start hearing from me. Like, please, like, if you're like, wow, I really love this Leonie Dawson, I'm going to go follow her on social media. No, fuck social media, because you've liked a billion people and never heard from them again. Like, seriously, it's the worst way to stay in touch. So let me send you love letters instead. I send you a free letter every single week with free shit in it, and guaranteed, like, I treat you like a best mate, because that's how, like, a lot of the people on my list are my mates, so I want to treat them incredibly well. So that's another goal of mine.
So more lead magnets, more goodies.
More, like, I'll create more courses, because that's what I love doing, and then podcasts, and whatever way I want to express myself, I want to do more of those things.
Beautiful. Yeah. So, and it's true. I when I see a newsletter come from you, I'm like, oh, fuck, good. <You know? laughs> And it's a special thing, you know, like I don't want to just read it on the fly. I want to know it's there, and then I'll make a cup of tea and I'll sit down and read Leonie's newsletter, because they are a joy. They're beautiful to receive. They put a really big, big sparkle in your day. And that's what you want from someone that you're subscribing to. You want to feel like you're their friend. You want to feel some intimacy there. Yeah. And from a creative point of view, that is so much joy to be creating that and to be thinking about that all the time. What else can I do to make this person feel held and feel special? Yeah. And that gives us a lot of satisfaction as creatives.
It does. And that way as well, when I meet people on the street and they're like, hi, I know who you are. I'm like, fucking bring it in. It's amazing. Like, it's such a great way to make friends, because I already know that they love me and that therefore they're really cool people with amazing judgment. You are interested in the same shit as me. So we're instant mates.
Yeah, absolutely. And one of the ironies too of having an online business, I think, is that a lot of your real life friends don't know as much about you as your online friends do. I find that to be a really strange kind of situation, because people who read your blog and stuff, they get more of your inner thoughts, they get more of your day-to-day life than you know, a good friend who you only see every 6 months and have the occasional phone call with, who you still consider to be a really dear and precious friend. They don't see all that other stuff that's going on. So it's a strange, strange world, the online world. Yeah.
That's true. I think, I'm trying to think. Yeah, no, I do have quite a few friends who've known me for a really long time and who just won't read my blog whatsoever. And so I'm like, oh, do we have a lot to catch up on?
Yes.
What?
Well,
it's also weird.
Well, you feel like, so, did you read my blog? Yeah, why are you asking me that question? Didn't you see my blog? Of course they didn't see your blog. They couldn't give a shit about your blog.
But they'll be really excited to tell someone something. I'm like, oh, my God, I need to tell you about this. Like, I listened to your podcast already. I know about that.
Bugger.
Hey, well, tell me what's happening with you.
Yes. So, which leads me into another one of your habits, which you've touched on already, is social media negatively impacts your creativity. Can you expand on that a little bit more?
Sure. So as we've talked about, I don't really have an inner critic. I'm pretty happy just to enjoy whatever comes through me. And I noticed in the last 12 months or so that I was starting to second guess myself and compare myself to others and think, well, you know, should I really create this? Like, other people have already created stuff already. And I thought, oh, this is interesting because I know it's man-made. You know what I mean? Like, I know it's a construct because I haven't experienced it before. So this is also not a fun way to live, and it's not how I want to spend my time thinking like this. So I need to start doing some human experiments to find out what is causing this. So I deleted Facebook and Instagram off my phone. And I kept on, like, I can keep Messenger on there because that way I'm just talking to friends, you know, like I don't feel like I'm missing out on anything. I'm still texting with friends, but it stops that endless scroll of just consuming content. And especially Instagram, because it's like something about the visuals on it. It's, I don't know, it does something to your brain. And I noticed within like 1 week of me, like, taking it off my phone, one, my phone screen time was like way down. It like killed off completely because when you don't have that infinite scroll, there's not that compulsion anymore. Yeah. Like you can check messages, but that's about it. And I started, my brain started coming back on board in terms of what I wanted to create. So I thought, fuck this for a joke. This is a good experiment and I shan't do that again. So, I will actually install my apps in order to post content and then I try and delete them back off again.
Right. Wow.
Yeah.
And you schedule?
I do some scheduling, and then there's some stuff we can't schedule because my it's like video and carousel shit, which we can't automate just yet. So I just send it to my assistant for her to do as soon as she like starts working for me in the mornings. Plus that's always a better time. I'm never online when everybody else is online. I'm always online at like 2 p.m. Australian time, where there's nobody online except for the random Australian creatives.
Speaking of which, this is going off on another tangent, but I'd be interested to know why you feel that you have such a huge following in the States. So have you got any explanation for that? You know, why it was the States that really, you know, people in the States that really took to you first?
Nah, no idea. Absolutely no clue.
Yeah.
Because I haven't toned down the swearing. And as we know, Australia, the Americans don't really love the swearing. So I think the ones that do enjoy a bit of swearing are like, oh, it's someone that swears. Maybe it's the accent. Maybe it's because I'm ridiculously hot. I don't know and I don't care. Like whoever rocks up is great. Yeah. I also seem to have a disproportionate number of people in Germany who love me. Don't know why, but let's go with it.
Okay. It's really interesting. The demographics are, you can never pick who's going to follow and who's going to, you know, it's just like real life really.
Yeah, no clue.
So fun, ridiculous side projects. So I know you've got your beautiful creative journal, you know, snail mailing its way around the world. But what about ridiculous fun projects? Like, would you consider, I saw you doing up your studio, that I wouldn't call that ridiculous, but it was a lot of fun to watch you do that and watch you, you know, you bashed in a window and you painted the walls aqua and all the beautiful things that you did. That's kind of like a fun project. Are there other things like that go on? Or
yeah, I smashed out, like I did some demo work on our house and smashed out half a wall as well. It was so much fun. Honestly, I just was so woman with a power tool. Like anything I can make is really cool. We also, like when we moved into this property, we're on a couple of acres. We bought it from some 90-year-olds, not 19. I said to them, look, if you want to leave your statues here, because they were moving into a tiny townhouse, I said, go for it. So they ended up leaving like these really weird old, like kind of Grecian statues all through our gardens. And it took us ages to find them all. And then there was like weird, like flamingo ones and all kinds of stuff. And so for like months on end, me and the kids would like go and drag them out of the garden. And then we would paint them with crazy colors. And my husband bought a bulk pack of googly eyes. And so we like googly-eyed all of them. So and now when you walk around our property, there's like all these like garishly like Grecian with weird eyes. Like, that shit just makes me laugh.
Something out of a Tim Burton movie.
It is. It is. Love and my it. Kids are like, what can we paint now, Mom? Like, what can we make now? So my kids are just, they know that they can just paint whatever they like. Mom, I found a chair up the back. Can I go paint it? Sure. My daughter, like, we've got an old shed up the back that was kind of abandoned. And there was a stepladder in there. And my 10-year-old, like, just dragged it back to the house and painted it all up and collaged the top of it. And now it sits in her room as this kind of art piece, and it's very cool. So that's the kind of shit that I like to get into. Just whatever you feel like fucking doing, just do it.
And that's the sort of stuff that you can achieve when you have, as you described it, a homely life.
Yeah.
When you're not, you know, madly scheduled and trying to achieve all these other things, you're just kind of living your life.
Yeah. And
allowing the flow to flow through you. Yeah. It's
like beautiful. Yeah, it's like a quarantine life without the enforced.
Yeah.
Because everyone started getting into hobbies. Like, everyone started getting into cooking when we were in quarantine. Like, we can't do those nice things just at home.
Just without without it being imposed on us. Yeah.
Without there having to be a pandemic, you know.
Yeah. Can you, as we get down the pointy end of the window of the interview, can you just explain in a bit more detail the wild donkey technique? I just adore the wild donkey, and it's really helped me, you know, to get on with stuff. It's inspired me, it's energized me when I've been flagging to read it online, and I've also got it printed out, of course. Aww. It's just got some kind of magic about it.
It does.
And I adore it. And I've also got you reading it, you know, speaking it in one of the courses. I think it's in one of the courses I did with you, which was the 40 days to create an e-course. I think it's in self-sabotage, in the self-sabotage solution.
Oh, it would be. Yeah, right on. Yes.
And I love listening to it, because just hearing you speak it gives that other level to it. Yeah.
That makes me so happy. Oh, I love you, Jen. <That's my darling. laughs> I will say, everyone, like, if you think you're Jen's number one fan, you're wrong. It's my daughter, Starry, because Starry is like a devotee of Jen. And she's got all of her audiobooks and all of her books. And Jen was so fucking delightful and sent Starry a little care package with some of her stuff in there, including posters and illustrations from it. Starry, like, I've never been such a cool mum as that day. Like, never, ever. Like, signed books from Jen Stora, and Star was just shitting her pants when it's right. Okay, wild donkey.
Back to the wild donkey.
So the wild donkey is how I consider creative projects. So all you have to think of is, like, when you have a creative idea, it's just like a wild donkey turning up in your paddock. And all you have to do is ride the donkey until it's done, and then let it free into the world again as soon as you can. Because here's the thing, the longer you think about the project, the more, like, the harder work it becomes, and you lose the interest and the enthusiasm and the excitement. You have to, like, stay with the energy of it, because when you start a project, there's a whole lot of excitement about the idea. The longer you sit on a project, the energy drains away. It's sort of like, you know, like a seed bomb, you know, when, like, seeds that people put them in their bombs so you can throw them into gardens and they start self-propagating. So it comes with its own dirt and its own, like, shit in there, like manure and stuff, so that as soon as water strikes, it can just bloom. So I just want you to think about, like, an idea in that same way. Like, it has everything inside it, like, that seed is ready to germinate and bloom into a mighty oak tree. And so all you have to do is just pour your attention on it for a little while. And here's the thing, like, if I said to you, you have 6 months to write a book, like, it is going to take you 6 fucking months. And you'll get to 5 months and you'll be like, oh my God, I haven't started writing a book. And you'll be just thinking about it and talking about it, and everyone just hates you for continuing to talk about this motherfucking thing that you should just be doing instead. Nobody will hate you. They'll accept you unconditionally, of course, but they'll be like, can you just do the fucking thing? So instead, you could just like ride the donkey now and get it done ASAP, release it back out into the wild. And here's the thing, when you do that, when you finish a project and release it into the wild, you get another surge of energy, right? So you get the surge of energy at the start of the project and at the end of the project. But like the middle parts, bullshit, like they are energy deficit. So if you can bring them closer so that the energy kind of overlaps, that's going to help you. And also, once you finish this project, you've got more energy to do another project. Ta-da! And so you just end up becoming that much more efficient. For those who follow wild donkeys, they give themselves really ridiculous deadlines and then mono focus on it to make it happen, get it done, release it into the world, and move on to the next thing.
I like this idea of monofocus as well as, yeah, just going down that rabbit hole and staying there until you come out the other side. Another analogy. Yeah.
And it's a beautiful way to really immerse yourself in the healing experience of creativity.
Why do you think creativity is so healing?
Because it's an opportunity for you to finally sit down and listen to the voice inside you and listen for the voices of the angels as well and allow them to pass through you.
So you're connecting with something bigger than yourself.
Yeah. But even if you just connect with yourself, that's a holy thing as well.
Yeah. And then that has a run-on effect in terms of healing.
It's exceptional. And here's the thing, when we get given these ideas, because I believe the ideas are given to us by angels because they need to be in the world, these projects, they will go on to heal so many people. But the person it heals first and most is the hands it moves through. So if you've been given a project to work through and you allow it to come through you, you're the one that gets healed first and most of all from that project. Like me writing that erotic novella, just one of those ridiculous fun side projects, that means more to me than it will ever mean to a reader. Even though, you know, it's brought so much joy to readers, it's brought a lot of joy to their partners because it's incited a lot of sex. Sexy times, yay, woo! But first and foremost, it was amazing for me to do it.
And it was amazing for you to do it because it was something so different to what you normally do, do you think? Or it was just something that was burning inside that you really wanted to. I know you're a massive fan of erotic fiction. You read a lot of romance novels and I love imagining you there at the weekends, you know, going through the
just like, and what are they saying next?
So it's almost kind of like, would you say it was like fan fiction that you write, or was it just really just a wild donkey?
It was a wild donkey, and also because it was outside of my usual creative process. I hadn't written fiction since I was, you know, in high school when I'd last been assigned an assignment for it, you know, and I used to love doing it. I thought it's a red hot bummer that I haven't been doing more of this. I write a lot of nonfiction, clearly, but it was like, and also because in some ways I knew it wasn't going to be likely profitable and that it was completely out of the realms of my business, I just wanted to do something for me, just as a fun, ridiculous side project and give myself the gift of doing something wild that I'd wanted to do for years. And it just ended up being such a glorious gift.
Anything else on like that on the horizon?
Who knows? I'll wait for it to jump upon me, really. A lot of people want me to write another erotic novella, Salt Number 2. But I don't know what's next, but whatever comes through me, I'm so happy to be there for it.
Yeah. I don't imagine that you would be the kind of person that would do something simply because people were asking you to do it either. I can't.
No. Never. Just.
It has to be from the heart. It has to be something that you have a burning desire to do, not that you're signing up for. Yeah.
I mean, I do, like, I do get asked constantly for like my next marketing course.
Oh, I see that.
And yeah. I will probably acquiesce to that demand.
Yeah.
But I do want to do it. And also because I do want to not have to say the same thing over and over.
Yeah.
Which was actually going to share.
That was actually going to be my next question. You know, what sort of e-courses are you cooking up now?
Sure.
What have you got in the background?
So first and foremost.
Hang on.
Yes.
Which was the other course I did? That 40 Days to Create an E-Course.
Mm.
That's got a massive section about marketing, like a massive section about marketing. And it's a it's just so good, like it's spot on. So every time I go to write sales page or write a sales email, I go back to that and remind myself of what I've learned in it, sharing your brownies. You know, when I start to get scared and think, oh, people are going to think I'm hammering them, you know, or that sort of thing, I go back to sharing your brownies. You know, you can't hide in the kitchen and say, fuck off, I'm not going to give you any of my brownies.
Exactly.
People listening to this will go, that's marketing advice. Marketing advice.
It really is. Yes.
The biggest hurdles is actually being brave enough to step up and sell.
The mindset.
It's a mindset, yeah.
Yeah, it's really important. And you're right, there is a really big marketing section in there. Just there's so much more to say as well.
Right.
So,
yeah.
And so I'll probably do one specifically on sales pages and to really like guide people through that process, because it's where I like keep on seeing people get stuck over and over again. So I don't like repeating myself. So if I can just go, no, just go do that fucking course. That'll be Bonza. But I'm so glad that you actually use the marketing materials. And that's what I keep saying to people right now is go to the e-course and do the marketing stuff in there.
Yes. Be an Ingrid, the implementer.
That's right. Yay. Yeah. Number implement. One student.
Yeah. Implement. That's what it's all about.
Yeah.
You can't just let it all wash over you and think, well, that was fun.
It's true.
You know,
it's
do
true.
Your thing. Do the thing.
Yeah.
So a marketing course is
yes.
So a much more in-depth marketing course.
Yeah, likely just about sales pages, copywriting, that kind of stuff, because I realized like there's so many avenues, so I might build out some more courses that are specifically just about one thing. I used to have Double Your Business. I mean, you probably took that if you're in the academy.
Yeah.
And Double Your Business was kind of like the all-encompassing one. It was like 40,000 words. It was massive. And so I wanted to update that and then bring it out into kind of more bite-sized actionable bits, because Double Your Business was a monster of an e-course, hugely useful, but I want to try and break it down and make it even more actionable for people. 2021 goals workbooks I'm working on at the moment. We'll probably have some more like companion products this year for it as well. So that's my next focus. And then we'll just see what happens after that. It's just general ideas at this point. So I know I've got to get the workbooks and then a marketing course done, and then we'll see what happens after that.
Yeah, well, that's
that.
A fair bit.
I know. Yeah. And then I was going to do them both at the same time, and my osteopath was like, Leonie, do you really think that's a good idea when you've got a back injury? And I was like, okay, I'll do it one at a time. Right. So doctor's orders.
And the truth is, a lot of this stuff is hard on your body. We look at builders and painters and people out there in the world, tradespeople, and that, and think how hard they work physically. But it's really hard on your body. Illustrating and writing has its own drawbacks in terms of your body. So you do have to be careful. You do have to nurture yourself and pace it a little bit. Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. I've got a condition called hypermobility, which means I dislocate easily. So I just dislocated both hips and prolapsed a lumbar disc from walking. So just from walking. It's just so stupid. But it is what it is. So I'm on a 4-month recovery and rehabilitation for that. So I'm not allowed to do anything really. I'm not allowed to bend down, pick anything up. I can't carry anything, and it's just so frustrating because I want to move all of the furniture in my house. Like, I just want to move everything around, redesign everything, and I can't. But anyway, I'll have to wait and Yes, pace myself. Ew, what an awful word for a wild donkey rider.
Yes, yes. Oh, Leonie, it's been so beautiful to talk to you. I've just enjoyed every minute. I could go on and on.
But I love you, my friend.
And you need to rest as well.
Yeah, I'll have a little lay down.
Yeah, and you'll be doing live calls. I think you've got. Have you got a live call tomorrow with the Get Shit Done Club? Or
Friday. Mm. Yeah, and that'll be Bonza, and yeah, it's all pretty groovy. I feel like a very lucky human to do what I do, and I love that I get to connect with people like you and like adopt you into my friendship. So cute person. So guys, like, that's the thing, get a business so you can like really easily find more friends.
Absolutely. Oh, you do it so well. You do all of it so, so well, Leonie. You're just such a brilliant role model. And I think about what my life would be like without you there. And it's just a lot duller. And I certainly would not have achieved what I've achieved and how I've helped lots of people through Girl in Dark. None of that would have happened if I hadn't started tapping into your energy and saying, well, she's doing it. She's doing it. There's a role model, you know, as you said, that patriarchy colonizes our brains, tells us what we can and can't do, and we don't question it until somebody else goes pop and pops out of the box bless and starts you. Doing stuff like you.
Bless so. You, Jen. I'm so glad that you're in the world and doing the work that you're doing, and you are just a joy to so many, and you bring so much love and light. And I think, Starry is like your truly tan fan, but Beth really, really loves Pig Day Out.
Because Clary has a lot to poo.
Yeah. Oh, he's got lots of poo. Like, you can't go past a good poo joke for a 6-year-old.
Absolutely
like,
not. Absolutely.
There's
not.
Nothing else.
In fact, you can carry it on for a long time.
It's true. Yeah. And my kids, like, because they've got your name, like, to Starry and Beth in your books as well. I'm like, does everyone get to have their name written in books, Mummy? And I'm like, no, shush.
That's so sweet. Some of them don't like it. Some of them go, she's defacing my book, you know.
Oh, the cutie so pies.
Yeah, you have to sort of pick your person that you're going to sign for. Yeah.
Oh, that's cute. My children like those. They'll get through life, and then when they're adults, they're like, "How come when I buy a book, it doesn't have my name in there?" From it's so weird.
It's not dedicated to me. Doesn't mention my birthday or Christmas.
It's so funny.
All right, Leonie, it has been absolutely a joy, and I hope that we can do this maybe again in another year's time, see where you're at.
That'll be
again,
a dead set joy.
I'm in there in the Get Shit Done Club, touching base and, you know, keeping track of you and what you're up to. And
babes, I love you big heaps, and blessings on all your creations every offering you have.
Okay, loads of love. See you again. Bye, Leonie.
Bye.